Okay, welcome to this lecture on the IO techniques. So the last lecture we were looking at the three different techniques that is possible to perform the IO operations with the external peripheral devices. The first technique we were looking at was the programmed IO technique. And the second technique was the interrupt driven IO technique. And the third technique, which is going to be the focus of this lecture, is going to be on the DMA or the direct memory access technique. So quickly recapping the previous two techniques, and we looked at the programmed IO. Now ideally what happened here is the processor entirely dedicated its task for performing the IO operations, right? So what was happening here is the data is basically it was exchanged between the processor and the IO module. So what the processor is going to do is dedicatedly going to check with the IO module by sending the command to the IO module, and it has to wait till the IO module goes on to finish that particular operation or the command that the processor has basically requested here. And so the processor must wait till the IO module completes it. So the drawback that we saw here was there's going to be a wasting of time at the processor end, right? Which the other alternate technique, the interrupt driven technique, what it was trying to do here is it was trying to partly reduce the load of the processor, where the interrupt IO technique can actually free up the processor to some extent, right? Where once the processor issues an IO command, it can go on to do continue its other instructions unless or until interrupted by the IO module when the IO module basically completes its work. So till then it can basically go on to do that. But once the IO module goes on to interrupt, right, the processor has to switch on to execute the respective interrupt service routine by the respective IO device, which has actually raised that interrupt. So we were looking at the different kinds of interrupts and all that, right, from the hardware interrupt that comes in and with reference to finding out which device were there. So the concept of vectored interrupt, the polling mechanism and all that was discussed in the last class. So, but ultimately what is happening here is it is all about, reading or writing data to an external peripheral, right? So either I'll have to read the data from the peripheral and then put it onto my main memory, or whatever is there in my main memory, I'll have to basically extract that and then display, send it to the external peripheral, which can be an output device. So the processor here is entirely taking care of, extracting the data from the IO module and putting it into the main memory, or storing from the input device in the main memory. So this was entirely being done by the processor, where still the processor is doing a part of the task there. So the aspect came in where can we still further reduce the processor involvement and improve the efficiency, where we could bring in another module which is called as the DMA module, where the IO module and the main memory can exchange data directly without much involvement of the processor, but through this DMA controller, which can basically perform that particular task. So these are the three different flowcharts to differentiate these three techniques. So when you basically see in the programmed IO, what happened was the processor basically issues the command and it is going to wait till, so processor issues the read command to the IO module, so it goes to the IO module. The processor, IO module basically, the status of that is going to be set in the status register of the IO module, which the CPU has to actually, go and check the status register of the IO module. So till the status is basically ready to perform, the operation of, say, the read wording. So once the status register is set, which is being looped and checked periodically by the processor, you can't do the operation. The processor has to wait dedicatedly. So once the status register is set, you can read the word from the IO module. So once you're reading, what is the idea here? You basically have the CPU processor has to write the word into the data memory by placing the word in the data bus and putting the address where that word has to be stored. Once that is done, you go on to execute your next instruction. So this is basically the idea behind programmed IO. Whereas in interrupt IO, what happened is this entire waiting of CPU was reduced, where once the CPU issues the command, the CPU goes on to perform its other task and all that. Whereas once the IO module completes the operation of all that, it goes on to send an interrupt, right, to the CPU, where the CPU goes on to fetch the word and all this and try and then write it to the memory. So here, if you see, the entire operation of the processor doing this checking and all that is being reduced, where once the CPU goes on to outsource the job of what block of data has to be read, where to be writing it, all that, if it tells to the DMA, the DMA will take care of doing the programmed IO what the CPU was doing, right? And then the DMA will raise an interrupt to the CPU to basically fetch the data. So this is the entire idea. So we'll get on to the depth of the DMA basically waits. So yeah, we were so interrupt IO, if you basically see, it's more efficient than the programmed IO where that needless waiting is being done. But what is that potential upgrade that you can see where we can further improve the interrupt IO? So we're going to optimize, we're still going to have an interrupt, but how can we further reduce of the processor is what we are trying to focus in this DMA concept. So in interrupt IO, still consumes a lot of processor time because the data is exchanged between the memory and the IO module, correct? Via the processor. So but this exchange still needs to go through the processor, right? So the processor spends time transferring the data, which while during that time it can do something useful. So that time where something to be useful to be done, to be enabled to do that something useful, DMA module comes into picture. So what is that DMA module here is we are going to have this IO module directly copy that into the memory by passing the processor via this DMA module. So DMA module is going to be instructed by the processor to basically do where to access the data from, right? Giving all the sort of inputs to the DMA module so that the DMA module can entirely take care of doing the IO operation via the IO module. So it's going to unburden the processor, it's going to combine with the interruption scheme for optimum efficiency, and that's the entire idea behind direct memory access. So we are not bypassing the processor. So it's just going to be the controller is going to be another coprocessor that's actually going to unburden the original processor. So just like how the IO module was basically used to unburden the processor of the various peripherals that you have, right, which is basically going to act as a mediator here in terms of the IO module, DMA is going to act as a mediator between the processor and the the memory and the IO module that is there. So let's prove, right? Let's take up the function here. So DMA, if you see, it's an additional module hardware that you're going to interface to the system bus, fine. So what happens now is the DMA controller is going to take over from the CPU for the IO. It's going to be stored in the data count register. That's why you see all these is being mapped to the data lines, where all that is going to be fed to the respective registers. CPU there. So this is what the CPU is fine initially going to tell you to the DMA, and that tells DMA please take care of it. So once it says all this, the CPU can go on to carry with other works, and the DMA controller will go on to basically deal with the transfer. Okay, so once DMA completes it, it's going to send an interrupt when it has finished this entire set of IO operations. But the very important concept that's going to come in here is, see, the processor is actually going to use the system bus. The DMA module is going to use the system bus. So someone here has to be arbitrated, right? Which means that when the processor basically has to be put on hold, or when the processor is not using the system bus, then only the DMA can use it. But when the DMA is basically performing the operation, the DMA has to force the processor to basically, use the system bus. So at least for a bus cycle where I need to basically read a word, from the module and then place it in the memory, I have to use the bus, correct? So I am going to now do some concept called cycle stealing, right? Where I am basically going to, steal the system bus and put the processor on hold till I finish that transfer of a word of data. Okay, so what's the DMA module going to do here is, the processor is basically going to be suspended, right, for some time when the DMA module is actually going to be using the system bus there. So the DMA module is basically going to transfer one word and then returns the control back to the processor. So okay, so what's basically going to happen is it's not an interrupt where CPU is not basically going to switch any context, save things and all that. CMA is just the CPU is just going to be suspended, right, before it acts the bus, so that you're slowing down the CPU a bit. But ultimately what's happening here is the processor is just going to pause for some bus cycles here. So though the processor is going to be executed slowly in this case, nevertheless, what's going to happen here is you're going to have the DMA being far more efficient than the interrupt driven mechanism, because the CPU is not going to switch the context and all this. It is just being suspended for the cycle for the DMA to basically do all these word transfers of the IO, right? And it could be, you know, doing large blocks of transfer very efficiently, which is forcing the processor at times of bus cycles where it can basically, you know, use the system bus here. So that idea behind cycle stealing here, where when the processor is having these several machine cycles in a particular instruction when it is fetching, right? When I have to fetch, say, do a memory read by the processor there, right? I'm going to decode that instruction, fetch the operand, execute. All these are going to be part of the machine cycle that is there, correct? So here, apparently, the DMA is actually going to steal for some time, where it might basically have to send a hold to the processor while performing the instruction itself, right, during this machine cycle, where it can steal one of the bus cycle to basically transfer a word at that time where the processor is going to be put down. So this entire idea behind having breakpoints in between, right, where the processor is executing its set of instructions, so to enable the DMA to use the system bus, is going to be the mechanism that the DMA module incorporates. Right, so potentially what's going to happen is we are going to have lots and lots of transfers of words, you know, blocks of transfer being done directly by the DMA without involving the processor, but just have to suspend the processor sometime till this basically happens. Now let's look at where how can you configure, right, the DMA module with reference to the system bus and the IO modules. So the first configuration that we're going to do here is all the modules that you see here is actually going to share the same system bus, right? So it's a single bus here, but the entire problem, yeah, as you know, that DMA is going to act like a coprocessor here, which is going to use the programmed IO to basically exchange the data between your memory and there, which basically means what? Suppose it has to basically, you know, write to the IO device, it has to fetch from the memory, it's going to take one bus cycle, and then it has to write to the IO, which basically means it has to use the again system bus here. So at least two bus cycles would have been required, because from, say, you know, reading from the IO to the DMA and from DMA to the memory, which is to write, you basically have to use your system bus. So which means CPU is suspended twice. So this is one very simple configuration where all are using the shared system bus here. But the better configuration would be for architecture, the configuration that we're trying to utilize when we interface the DMA controller with the IO process. So let's now get on to a much interesting aspect here. From a hardware perspective, let's look at the ICs involved and look at one DMA controller IC, which is A237A, which is going to be, say, interfaced with the 8086 processor, and say the memory, we're going to have a DRAM memory, and the IO device that we're literally going to look at is a secondary disk, right, the hard disk and all this. So typically it's a storage here, but what we can do here is from the main memory we can write to the secondary memory, right, or from the secondary memory you can write to the main memory. So this is something that we could go on to have in a typical case. So when you interface a DMA controller, right, to the processor and to basically this external device, what is all the hardware pins that you require in a CPU is something that we are going to, because the DMA has to, you know, put the CPU on hold state, and so there is definitely going to be some pins dedicated to put the CPU on hold state, right? And ultimately there should be a mechanism where the DMA can start the transfer, right? There should be some pins to do that, and what operation that the DMA is going to do with reference to the memory and to the IO, whether it's going to do a memory read or memory write, IO read or IO write, all has to be specified, you know, in this. So let us now look at the picture here. Right now, this is basically your CPU. This is your DMA chip 8237, which is basically interfaced to the system bus. You see the data bus here, you see the address bus here, you see the control lines here coming in. This is the main memory, and this is basically your IO device. So the IO device is basically interfaced to your DMA, right? And then the DMA is basically interfaced to the system bus there, correct? And so what's going to happen is we're going to look at two pins in the processor, which is HRQ. What is HRQ? HRQ is basically a hold request, you know, and hold acknowledgement. So hold acknowledgement is something coming from the processor to the DMA, and hold request signal is something which is sent from the DMA chip to the processor there. So what's going to be the sequence of steps that is basically going to happen is something that you will have to understand here. So the DMA module basically needs to use system bus, right, to basically transfer the data. So what's going to happen now is it has to first send a signal called hold to the processor. Once the processor responds to that, it can respond with an hold acknowledge signal indicating that the DMA module can go on to use the system bus. So that's the entire idea that is basically going to do. So when hold acknowledgement comes in, then the DMA module can transfer a block of data from the main from the disk to the memory there. So this basically has to be performed. So now let's look at, there is going to be some set of other signals that is there. So now what's happening here is the peripheral device, which is a disk controller here, right, will actually request the service of the DMA here, right, by pulling this signal called dRequest. Now what is dRequest here is I am requesting the DMA to basically help me to pull the data, right, from the peripheral device. So what's basically going to happen here is once the DMA request is sent by the peripheral device to the DMA module, right, what the DMA has to do, which means I have something which is asked, requested by the IO device. So I basically have to send a hold signal, right? The DMA has to send a hold signal to the CPU. So that is going to be there. The DMA will put a high on the hold request, signaling the CPU through the hold pin, right? That it needs to use the bus. Once the CPU basically cannot straight away, send the hold acknowledgement, at least the current bus cycle, which is a part of the machine cycle that is there, if it finishes, right, it can actually respond to the DMA request by putting an high on the HLDA, which is basically your hold acknowledge, right? So once that basically means that the A237 can basically go ahead and perform its operation. So once the DMA gets the hold acknowledgement, then this guy will basically send a DAC signal to the peripheral device. Now what do you mean by DAC is it is called a DMA acknowledgement. So once DMA acknowledgement basically comes in, it can basically go on to start to transfer the data there. So what's happening there? So DMA can start to transfer the data, say from the memory to the peripheral, right, by putting what? So I was telling you that the CPU is actually going to instruct the DMA what's basically going to be the start of the address, from where it has to say read the data, write the data to, and the number of blocks of words that it has to be done. So that actually is going to be taking care here, which means this DMA can start to transfer the data from the memory to the peripheral by actually placing the address of the first byte of the block, right, where the data has to be read or written. So that has to be placed in the address bus, right? So the DMA is going to place that address on the address bus, and it is going to activate, say now it is going to read from the memory and write it into the peripheral. So it is basically going to say send the memory read signal and put the address of the first byte of the block inside the address bus and the control bus respectively, right? Once that has been done, it can read that particular byte, and that particular byte is going to be placed in the data bus. So once it's done, placed in the data bus, the next signal that I'm going to do is I have to write that particular block of word, the word, right, into the IO device. So which means I'll have to now send the IO write. The DMA basically has to now activate the IOW signal to activate the peripheral and write that particular word which is on the data bus onto the peripheral device, so which is the external disk here. So once this is done, we were telling that this is going to be a large block of transfer that is there, because the processor has already told the DMA, come on, this is going to be the starting address, and the data count is also given, which means how many blocks of words of data, right, has been done. So the counter now should be decremented, and the address pointer has to be incremented to the next one, so that I can keep processing this for fetching all this block of data that is there. And once I finish the entire block of transfer till the counter becomes zero, right, I'm going to hold the bus here. So once the DMA has finished this, then what should I do? Since this hold is already in a high, I basically have to deactivate the hold signal now, so that it basically means that the CPU now can go ahead and use the bus. So I basically steal the cycles of the CPU here in order to perform my operation via all this hardware pins that is basically there. I have achieved this stealing concept. So while DMA is basically being using the buses, the processor was idle, and vice versa also, right? So this entire concept is called fly-by DMA controller. Okay, so data is not basically passed through and it's not stored in the DMA chip. It's only between the IO and the memory that the DMA is basically trying to do all the sort of transfer of words that is there. So that's the entire concept behind direct memory access, which is claimed to be the much more efficient IO technique scheme compared to the IO scheme. So once the DMA finished this, now you've been interrupted, right? So you CPU can go on to basically perform this entire task of the other set of operations that the CPU can do. Completes on the DMA. Now let's get on to the next topic, which is basically something called as bus arbitration technique. Now what do you mean by bus arbitration is something we'll have to understand here, because when you have a common system bus and there are multiple processors or the other modules which are trying to use a system bus, right, who's going to take control of the bus is something which we'll have to understand. And if there are proper arbitration mechanisms to basically deal that, that's going to be much more. Prior to that, we are going to understand three terms here, which we were also, using apparently in the DMA lecture, which is something called the difference between bus cycle, machine cycle, and instruction cycle. Now, ideally, if you see, all these terms are interrelated, where instruction cycle is basically the number of cycles taken to perform or execute your instruction there. And this instruction cycle is basically going to be, fetched, decoded, executed, and all this, and that's going to comprise several machine cycles. But the difference between bus cycle and machine cycle is something which we can appreciate, right? So let's take a bus cycle. The bus cycle is basically the cycle of time, or time basically required to make single read or write, depending on your data width or the data bus width, right? So you're going to transfer a word of say 8-bit, right? So what is that time to basically transfer that word over the bus is something which is called the bus cycle. So let's try to take that. Now, bus cycle is a sequence of events on the bus for transferring one word of information between the CPU and the memory. It can also be the IO, right? So you're not bringing even the IO peripherals here if you're interfacing to the system bus there. So what's going to happen now is we are basically going to either read or write one word of the data over the bus. So what's the time basically to do? So what kind of operations you can do here is you can use memory read, you can use the memory write, IO read, IO write, acknowledgement, all this. So when you say a memory read bus cycle can be defined as the cycle which basically the time that's needed to read one byte or one word from the memory. Similarly, if you're writing that, and typically for IO, it's basically from your input device, your module, you're going to read one byte of data, right, from the registers to place it on over the bus there, right? So similarly for writing one byte of data into the output port. And typically interrupt acknowledgement bus cycle is basically transferring the vector code, meaning the address of the device that you have to place there. So what's that cycle there? So how do you basically differentiate that with say the machine cycle here is, now say in an 8080 machine the data width is only 8 bits, and say you have to fetch 16 bits of data. What's going to happen now is it has to basically have two bus cycles, and the machine cycle is basically going to be say one cycle that comprises of two bus cycles to basically fetch that 16 bits of data or say the instruction that you basically have, right? So a machine cycle apparently depends on the width of your data as well as the bus as well, right? So that's going to limit in terms of the number of cycles that you basically need. So instruction cycle is depending on how many machine cycles are basically needed to complete an instruction, and that's going to vary for each instruction that you see there. So this is something understood, right? Some instructions like no op is not going to require nothing more than one machine cycle, but there can be instructions which is going to do all sort of things, storing, reading, all that, right? So it's apparently going to take more machine cycles, and apparently instruction cycles depend on the number of machine cycles that it basically takes. So now let's get on to this topic on bus arbitration. So what we're going to do now is we're going to use the terminology of master slaves which means a master is one who basically can claim the system bus or control over the system bus at a given time, whereas the other slave cannot become the master, you know, at that time. So it cannot initiate any bus cycle. So which basically means now the entire bus arbitration process is determining who the bus master is, who can get the bus control at a given time, when there is basically a request for claiming the system bus for more than one bus masters. Okay, so who all can basically claim the system bus is the question that we are trying to answer here, right? So the bus master can initiate and perform a bus cycle for data transfer, whereas a slave cannot basically become a bus master and hence cannot initiate bus cycle here. Now in most processor, if you see the processor, the DMA controller, they are basically the bus masters, right? Whereas the memory IO controllers are basically slaves here. So when it comes to between the processor and the DMA controller, who's basically going to use the bus? That's where you're looking at the cycle stealing concept and all that, right? Now some systems you basically have very intelligent IO controllers, which are also like a processor there, which is basically can also act as bus masters. But apparently now it's all about multiprocessors that you have, right? So all these multiple processors can share the bus and apparently all can become a bus master. So there is a need now where you basically have to bring in bus arbitration logic to decide who can actually access that particular bus at that particular time there. So when more than one bus master simultaneously needs the bus, that is where you will have to do the arbitration, who is going to claim control of the bus. Others should wait for their turn. So there should be, say, there are two types of bus arbiters. One is called a centralized bus arbitration. The other is called a distributed bus arbitration. So when you basically take a centralized bus arbitration, there is a dedicated arbiter who has the role of, you know, resolving these kind of issue when there are multiple masters trying to do, right? Whereas in a distributed bus arbitration, here all the bus masters will cooperate and jointly perform the arbitration, right? So if you look at all these bus masters, they have a section for arbitration which will help them to cooperatively in this particular case here. Now let's look at three different methods for bus arbitration. One method is called the daisy chain method. The next method is called the polling or the rotating priority method. And the third method is called the fixed priority or the independent request method. So we are trying to bring in priority here, which basically means some bus masters can be, you know, typically be given high priority, right? And so they basically can get access when you have multiple requests coming in. Well, there's some logic there, but ultimately what is that performance metric that we're going to look at here is the hardware cost, because when you're building arbitration mechanisms, you need hardware circuitry involved, and that's going to scale up your cost as well. But why I'm going to scale up my cost, what is that I'm literally trying to do here, is my arbitration response time. You know, how quickly you go on to resolve, right? Something that we will have to understand so that the bus can be efficiently being used by all these bus masters, and quickly you try to resolve the confusions that has been arrived during this case. So let's now look at daisy chain method. I think this topic you already looked at from the interrupt perspective. Now that interrupt perspective is basically going to be applied for bus arbitration as well. Here we're going to look at three different signals. There's going to be a bus request, there's going to be a bus busy, and there's something going to be bus grant. So what's going to happen is this is basically going to come in some form of centralized arbitration scheme, where the bus request signals of all the masters, right, forms one line bus, right? So there's going to be a bus request line, and there is going to be a bus busy, which is going to form another line bus, right, where you go on to say the output of all the bus master is going to basically be forming another line bus, which is called the bus busy. So when no bus master is going to use the bus, this line, bus busy line, is basically going to be inactive. But when you have bus request to be made, and when there are more, one or more bus requests present, and what's going to happen is the bus request line is basically going to be active here. So what's going to happen now is when you have one or more bus requests present, the BR line becomes active. It is now the role of the arbiter to basically initiate the arbitration by transmitting the bus grant signal. Okay, so there can be two cases here. What's going to happen now is daisy chain is basically a series where all your bus masters are being connected, right? When you transmit this bus grant signal, what's happening is it is going to pass via each and every bus masters. That's the idea. So the first master that is being interfaced near to the arbiter is always going to be the higher priority, who first gets the bus grant signal. So now there are two possibilities. First is the first master does not need the bus, which means he has not raised the bus request. There's some other bus master who has raised the bus request. So at that time, what he can do, he's not going to process that, right? Which means not wanted to use the bus request. He can just propagate that bus grant signal to the next bus master. So that is basically going to happen in the first case, where the first master has not required the bus. So now in other case, if the first master has actually wanting to use the bus, then he has raised the bus request. Now what happens now is this goes on to become the current bus master, and what he will do, he wants to basically use the bus, right? So he will issue the bus busy signal and is going to drop the bus request signal. So that's basically going to happen here. But in case if there are multiple bus request devices or masters which is raised, then the BR will still remain active, right? So that's again can be the case. Now in this case, what's happening now is the current bus master, first master, who is going to retain the bus, and since the bus busy signal has gone across, everyone knows that it's actually being used by some master here. This current bus master will go on to retain the bus and will come. What's going to happen now is it's basically going to be passed across to the next set of bus masters via the first master, because it has done its job. It does not have the request to basically do it. And so the only problem now is the request is first going to go to the guy which is closer to the bus arbiter, right? And so that's going to affect the service of the other bus masters which is not interfaced close to it. But this is the entire idea behind the daisy chain method. Here you see the master arbiter and you see the several bus masters coming in. There is a bus request line, there is basically a bus busy line, and the output of every device can basically show the bus busy signal or the bus request signal. And internally, if you see the logic here, right, the bus grant signal is actually going to be what's going to happen here is it's going to be propagated by acting like a switch in case if it is not going to be using here, right? So in case if the arbiter has been master is powered off, right, the one of the masters powered off, now the BG in input, bus grant input, should be shortened, right, to the BG output, right? So that's the dotted line that you see there. What happens is that this can propagate if this has not requested the idea of taking over the bus. So that's basically called polling to independently arbitrate. There is multiple bus master requesting, depending on the priority, right, I could grant the appropriate signal to the high priority device by the arbiter. So that's the entire idea behind independent request arbitration scheme. So what is more important now is when it comes to multiple processors, right, and all these memories trying to use the common system bus, there should be a bus arbitration logic which is trying to bring in. So if you're bringing in, say, a DMA controller, IO device and all this, the DMA controller also has to use the address lines, and you might have a multiple process system, you might have a DMA controller interfacing to several IO devices. So how is that you're basically going to have this bus arbitration logic, right, where DMA can go on to use the mechanism, whether it's going to be a daisy chain mechanism or a polling or independent request arbitration, can be any logic that you can apply. I hope that's the motivation behind this entire idea. These things you're already aware when it comes to bus, it's basically how are you organizing it, is the system bus, is the address bus, the data bus, the control bus and all that. So there's going to be a group of wires, lines, tracks carrying signals which is common to all these several hardware units, right? Now when you extend this address bus here, we were talking about memory mapped IO and all that, right? So the address bus can be used for two different purposes. One is to carry the address of the memory, right, while you're reading from a writing into the memory, and it can also carry the IO port address or the device address while it is trying to send or read data from a particular IO device there. So whether that is going to be mapped to the memory itself or it's going to be a separated isolated space, thing which we're trying to see. So this is quite an interesting picture which tells you about the entire, you know, bus level concept here, where you have this address bus, data bus, control bus, memory and CPU. Apart from that, now you're bringing in your IO devices also, the module devices, right, which is going to be interfaced to your system bus here. Now these IO devices basically can be the DMA controllers. It is interfaced to the system bus if you have a dedicated IO lines via the DMA controllers. So there's going to be a lot of signals that is going to come in here, right? We basically going to have memory read, memory write, IO read, IO write, and all this. So who's going to issue all that, whether it's the CPU or the DMA controller, this is another aspect, right? So that's the entire set of them. So when you basically say an address bus is going to be you know, unidirectional bus, which you generally, you know, seen there, right? So when it comes to CPU, CPU plays the address on the address bus, right? And data bus are generally bidirectional when it comes. So what the data bus can basically do here is you know, it can actually fetch the instruction from the memory, right? You want to fetch the operand from the memory, right? That's basically going to be used there. You want to store the result of an instruction into a memory, you need to use the data bus. You need to send a command to the IO device controller, right? You basically have to use the data bus. You need to read the status from the IO controller, right? You basically have to use the data bus. So all this is something where, you know, the data bus comes in. You need to read the data from the device controller to, and also to issue the data to the data device controller, right? All this, you basically need the data bus. Now the bus cycle concept comes in, whether when you're trying to, you know, fetch a read a word from the memory to the IO and all this, that's something on the bus cycle. Now control bus, if you basically see, there's going to be different control signals that is going to come in. Memory read, as you know, that the signal memory read can be issued by either the CPU or the DMA controller when they're performing a read operation with the memory, right? So what's the idea here is, memory read is going to be an input signal to which unit? It's basically going to be a you know, input signal to the memory unit, correct? And who basically places the memory read is on the control bus is the CPU or the DMA controller, right? So the memory reads out the data, and the address has to be placed in the address bus. Then only you can go on to read from the memory what is that, right? So that's the idea. And similarly for memory write, the signal is going to be issued by the CPU, right? And so while performing write operation, you know where to basically write the particular data which is in the data bus to the memory, correct? Similarly, IO read, if you take IO read, who's going to issue that? Now if the CPU is actually going to do a programmed IO, it's going to issue that signal while it's reading from the IO module, correct? So it has to basically, so the address of the IO device has to be placed on the, you know, data bus, right? And then you have to basically use, you know, say the DMA controller is being used to, you know, IO read signal to command an IO controller to place the data on the data bus, right? All this can basically be performed. So similarly for the IO write, you basically can go on to issue the IO write, right? And then particularly perform the writing of that data onto that particular IO, you know, device there. So all these are basically the different control signal when it comes into, you know, using the system bus there. I hope, yeah, that completes on the concept of bus arbitration as well as on the bus organization. Thank you.